Welcome to Space News from the Electric Universe, brought to you by the Thunderbolts Project at thunderbolts.info. The Electric Universe community consists of individuals who seem to share a common trait. That is the tendency to question ideas and beliefs that academia and society at large accept as true. It's easy to recognize the obstinacy or close-mindedness of others, but do we recognize these tendencies in ourselves? Today, Thunderbolts colleague Chris Reeve discusses the lifelong challenge that human beings face, both individually and collectively, to develop the necessary skills and means to determine what is true.
Although we don't normally experience it, people deal with fear and anxiety at every moment of our lives. Fear that the Earth might become uninhabitable, fear of war, fears about our family, and fear that we might lose our job. However, we don't feel these fears a lot of times, because we've created effective, largely subconscious, anxiety management systems. These subconscious systems provide us much comfort and room for more complex thought, insofar as they tirelessly work towards keeping us alive and out of harm's way. But they can also form a hidden barrier to the desire to adaptively change to our surroundings. The development of a more complex mental framework, a self-transforming mindset, can help the individual to recognize the filtering effect and limitations of his or her own frame of reference. The late philosopher Stephen Tolman once said, "A man demonstrates his rationality not by a commitment to fixed ideas, stereotype procedures, or immutable concepts, but by the manner in which and the occasions in which he changes those ideas, procedures, and concepts." Quoting Kierkegaard, he added, "Concepts like individuals have their histories and are just as incapable of withstanding the ravages of time as are individuals." I want to talk in this video about the psychology of change, and my intention is to show that changes to society's scientific worldview reflect in some key ways the process of change that occurs at the level of the individual. Both possess this inherent resistance to change, which some psychologists have likened to an immune system. Understanding how this immunity to new ideas works at both the individual and societal levels is a necessary prerequisite for any attempt to deeply understand how people engage scientific controversies. Most people who follow this business of change in the sciences will tend to point to the work of Thomas Kuhn, whose ideas are just as relevant today as they were when he said them in the 60s. I want to talk about his work, but I want to first diverge from the traditional treatment of this subject by also mixing in the more recent work of two Harvard psychologists, Robert KEGAN and Lisa Laskow LAHEY, authors of the book Immunity to Change, How to Overcome It and Unlock the Potential in Yourself and Your Organization. Although KEGAN and LAHEY wrote Immunity to Change to help individuals and businesses, their framework is also an unintentional commentary on the role of worldviews in scientific discourse. There are some important fundamental takeaways from KEGAN and LAHEY which we can put to use towards improving scientific discourse. I want to run through some quotes from their book to demonstrate them. Quote, "Many, if not most, of the change challenges you face today and will face tomorrow require something more than incorporating new technical skills into your current mindset. These are the adaptive challenges, and they can only be met by transforming your mindset, by advancing to a more sophisticated stage of mental development." Heifert said, "The biggest error leaders make is when they apply technical means to solve adaptive challenges." The mere existence of an immune system, which protects us but also precludes change, suggests that our tendency in the face of some challenge will be to seek out technical solutions, which abide by our pre-existing worldview. In certain circumstances, this system of immunity can actually block our ability to implement changes which we actually desperately desire. Note the interesting similarity in approach to ad hoc modeling, this increasingly common modeling technique which seeks to fit scientific theory to observations through tweaks to the prior underperforming model. As I read these quotes about our personal immune systems, think about how they might apply also to the larger scientific community as well. Change does not fail to occur because of insincerity. The heart patient is not insincere about his wish to keep living, even as he reaches for another cigarette. Change fails to occur because we mean both things. It fails to occur because we are a living contradiction. When we make a New Year's resolution, we look at the behaviors we seek to extinguish as bad. We look at the behaviors we want to amplify as good. But until we understand the commitments that make the obstructed behaviors at the same time brilliantly effective, we haven't correctly formulated the problem. We have learned something that may be very hard for successful, capable people to believe. More than we understand, most people deal constantly with fear. I'm not afraid. You know you are saying to yourself right now, I feel fine. And you are right. You do not feel your fear. The reason you do not is because you are dealing with it. Though you are not aware of it, you have created a very effective anxiety management system. And that system is what we call the immunity to change. But we run these systems, even highly successful anxiety management systems, at a cost. Inevitably, they create blind spots, prevent new learning, and constantly constrain action in some aspects of our living. These costs show up when we are unable to deliver on some genuinely desired change, the realization of which would bring us to a new, higher level of functioning in ways we truly want to attain. Most self-improvement efforts take place in too constricted a psychological space, blind to these bigger dynamics at play. However hard they work, however sincerely they seek to extinguish their obstructive behaviors, everything will go on within the existing mindset. No new learning can occur. When I read this book, I was just stunned by the applicability of these ideas to the world of scientific research, science education, and scientific discourse. KEGAN and LAHEY are not just describing the challenge of change within a personal context, which is their intended focus. Their analysis also applies just as well to the challenge of change in scientific theory. If they are right that leaders will tend to mistake adaptive change challenges for technical challenges, then this mistake should be written all over our worst performing scientific theories. In scientists' attempts to solve a stubborn problem, we should expect to see our most brilliant leaders applying the most sophisticated tools available to them, but restricted to the context of the accepted scientific framework. Reframing to an alternative framework would predictably reduce the available toolset, but it should not be surprising if it also offers far simpler solutions. These less technical solutions should not be judged inferior simply because they are less technical. Listen to KEGAN and LAHEY explain the immune system metaphor. We use the medical metaphor of immunity quite mindfully to signify that, first of all, this phenomenon is not in itself a bad thing. On the contrary, an immune system is, most of the time, a beautiful thing, an extraordinarily intelligent force that elegantly acts to protect us, to save our lives. However, in some instances, an immune system can threaten our continued good health. When it rejects new material, internal or external to the body, that the body needs to heal itself or to thrive, the immune system can put us in danger. In these instances, the immune system is no less focused on protecting us. It is just making a mistake. It does not understand that it must alter its code. It does not understand that, ironically, in working to protect us, it is actually putting us at serious risk. And this brings us to the second significant implication of KEGAN and LAHEY's work. KEGAN and LAHEY's solution to the problem, the way to achieve change, transcends all contexts. It is to seek to transform our subject-object relationships. Where we are currently subject to a mindset, we must learn to look at that mindset as an object. If that sounds confusing, just follow along and it will become clear. If necessary, pause the video and study the diagram on the screen. KEGAN and LAHEY state, the root of any way of knowing, what philosophers call an epistemology, is an abstract-sounding thing called the subject-object relationship. Any way of knowing can be described with respect to that which it can look at, the object, and that which it looks through, the filter or lens to which it is subject. Young children, for example, are still subject to their perceptions. So when something looks small to them, like cars and people viewed from atop a tall building, they think it actually is small. 3, 4, and 5-year-olds will look down and say, look at the tiny people. Children of 8, 9, and 10 can look at their perceptions. They will say, look how tiny the people look. A way of knowing becomes more complex when it is able to look at what before it could only look through. In other words, our way of knowing becomes more complex when we create a bigger system that incorporates and expands on our previous system. This means that if we want to increase mental complexity, we need to move aspects of our meaning-making from subject to object, to alter our mindset so that we have a way of knowing or making meaning becomes a kind of tool that we have and can control or use, rather than something that has us and therefore controls and uses us. Now, within that context, let's talk about Thomas Kuhn. Kuhn was famous for claiming that science is characterized more by the paradigms employed by scientists than by their methods of inquiry. What he seems to be arguing is that the scientific community is subject to certain fundamental ideas. Kuhn characterizes the history of science as exhibiting two fundamentally distinct scientific activities. One, which he calls puzzle solving or normal science, describes the majority of scientific work, conducting experiments, making observations, applying mathematical models. The second, much less common scientific activity is that of revolutionary science. This is the creation of new scientific paradigms. Many people are already familiar with Kuhn's basic claims, but perhaps fewer are aware of philosopher Tolman's interesting addition. He rebutted that paradigm change can occur during normal science too, through many minor conceptual shifts. Quote, in the evolution of concepts, as in biological evolution, Tolman argues, changes occur in populations. Novel concepts come and go, but they influence thinking in a given discipline only when conditions are favorable. Only when the new concepts have advantages can they displace others. Joseph Novak is an education theorist and the creator of the concept map approach to science education. He points to Tolman's claim that new ideas must find a niche in order to survive. What I would add to this is a warning to avoid constraining this notion of paradigm change to just conceptual bridges. I've over the years witnessed this conversation about what a paradigm shift towards electrical cosmology might look like. What I've observed is that these conversations almost always ignore the role of our system of communication in facilitating such changes. Yet these communication systems were never intended to service this goal of empowering and elaborating the most deserving novel scientific ideas. If that is what we want our online discourse systems to do, then that is what we must design them to do. In the same way that we had to build the internet to facilitate the nearly instantaneous transmission of imagery and videos across the globe, we must likewise squarely address this issue of how to identify the best ideas at the fringes of mainstream science if our goal is to facilitate paradigm changes in scientific theory. Academia has thus far refused to address this problem, probably because they are subject to it. But maverick thinkers who can observe the academic approach from outside of the university system have an advantage in that they can witness the problems of academic research as an object. What I'm saying is that outsider mavericks can play a critical role in the creation of discourse systems, which facilitate a more rapid rate of innovation within the sciences. And if such systems can be created, then it is inevitable that they will in due time be adopted by the academic community. There are several points I'd like to conclude with. First, the importance of qualitative research. There is this movement in academia to question the legitimacy of oftentimes qualitative research in disciplines like psychology and sociology. Simultaneously, the business community relies heavily upon this exact kind of research to make critical decisions about what products to create and sell. What I want to warn against is approaching this problem of improving the way we talk about science in some sort of anti-qualitative manner. As any employee of any modern software company will tell you, psychology and sociology are absolutely necessary to the design of modern software systems. Second, on the importance of worldviews in scientific discourse. Modern science journalism has for the most part attempted to mirror academia's decision to largely ignore many ongoing scientific controversies. But what will predictably happen with this approach is this logical fallacy of assuming that all other explanations have been ruled out. A vital aspect of forming expertise on scientific controversies is running claims back and forth. We need a scientific social network which is designed to focus upon this clash of worldviews in science. KEGAN and LAHEY state the problem as follows. If one is not to be forever captive of one's own theory, system, script, framework, or ideology, one needs to develop an even more complex way of knowing that permits one to look at, rather than choicelessly through, one's own framework. In such a case, that framework becomes more preliminary than ultimate, more in process than magnum opus. This breaks through to a bigger emotional and mental space that can seek out the framework's current limitations rather than merely defend the current draft as a finished product and regard all suggestions to the contrary as a blow to the self. These three qualitatively different levels of complexity, the socialized mind, the self-authoring mind, and the self-transforming mind, thus represent three distinct epistemologies. Each way of knowing maintains an equilibrium between what is subject and what is object. Growth in our way of knowing, adapting, involves disturbing this balance and learning to look at what we were before looking through. These are not just words to live by. It's also a philosophy which we should design the next generation of social networks with.
For continuous updates on space news from the Electric Universe, stay tuned to thunderbolts.info.